In this video, I'm going to show you how to build a reusable form component that you can use both to create something and then to edit the same thing afterwards. We're going to be using React Hook Form and Zot for this, and we're going to follow all of the best practices and design patterns in React as usual. Also, check out Project React in the description if you want a new way to learn React. So over here, I have a React application that's running. It's a pretty simple application. It has one component, the app component, that renders this div here with some styles, and then this user form component over here. Now, the user form component is a component that's already created. It already exists in this application, and our task is to add editing functionality to this form. Essentially, what we have here is we have a form that let's assume was built by somebody else in our team. Let's pretend that we're actually working on a product within a team, and that person only implemented the create functionality, which is what you're seeing here. This is how you create a form with React Hook Form. And now our task is to come into this form and add editing support to the same form so that we can use this to, because it's a user form, to both create a user and then edit that same user afterwards. This is what the form looks like. So we have user form here at the top, and then we have a couple of inputs: first name, last name, email, birthday, and role, and then this button to submit. Now the thing is, when actually we press submit button, first of all, this is not going to submit because this form currently is failing the validation checks. We actually need to have values in here for this to be able to submit. But the second thing is, we're not actually submitting anything to a real backend. This is just a simple video. This is a simple tutorial, if you will. And this, although it looks like we're sending some data to a backend, we actually don't have anything listening to /API/users. So this is not going to work. But don't worry about it. That's fine, because that's not what we're concerned with. We're not concerned with making this functional end to end. We're concerned with how we would go about adding edit functionality to this form in a way that is very simple, extensible, and that follows all of the best practices and design patterns around React. So let's get into it and let's do that. First of all, if you're not familiar with all of this, because this code is already here and it's set up an entire form with React Hook Form, I do have a whole tutorial video on React Hook Form that you can go and watch to get yourself up to speed. I'm not going to spend any time explaining really how all of this works. I would expect you to know at this point. And again, if you don't, there's the video that you can go watch to get yourself up to speed. So this form right now doesn't take any props. It just has this use form custom hook with register, set value, and handle submit, and then the on submit function. Here in the JSX, we have three inputs over here. As you can see, we have first name, last name, and email. These inputs are automatically managed by React Hook Form by the fact that we're using the register function over here, and we're passing it to the actual field that we want to register the input to. If you go here to our form field, we have birthday, email, first name, last name, and role. And these three over here, they are text inputs, so they're bound to these inputs over here. Then over here, we have more components. We have a date picker over here, and then we have a select component over here. Now, these ones are also part of the form, but they're managed manually. We're not using the register function because they're not simple inputs. They require a little bit more customizability and functionality, so we're doing things manually. On the date picker, we have the onChange event handler over here. We're accessing the date, and then if we have a date, we're setting directly the value of birthday to the value of the date. For the select, we're doing something very similar. On valueChange, we're actually getting the value from the function, and we're setting the value of the role to the actual value. Both of these components are built using SHA-CN. So if you want to see how they actually work, you can first of all access the code, because there will be a link to this repository in the description. But you can also go and check SHA-CN UI and see how they actually built their components, because there's a lot to learn from SHA-CN UI. It is a great library. So that's the current state of our form. And now our job is to add editing functionality to this form. So how will we do it? Right, we want this form to essentially be reusable so that you can either use it to edit a user if you have one, or you can use it to create a user if we don't have one, right? So we have to put all of that functionality inside of this form at every single step where it makes sense to do so. Now, if we actually look at the form schema over here, right, we have birthday, email, first name, last name, and role. We also have, if I open up here, user.ts, we have a type file which holds the type of our user. And as you can see here, the user has an ID and then has all of these properties over here that are the same exactly as the form. So we can actually use this user here and add it to the props of this component and make it receive an optional user. And then based off of that, we can determine if we should edit a user. So if we receive a user, we should be in editing mode. And if we don't receive a user, we should be in a create mode to create a new user from scratch, right? So I think that that's the first step that makes sense for us to do. So let's do that. Let's come here and let's create a new type for the user form props. So we're going to do type user form props. That is going to be an object. And over here, we're going to pass it user and then question mark. And we're going to do user like this and import this from /types/user. Now, you have to be careful when you're doing something like this because you have to be really smart about what you pass through the props to this component. In this case, we're passing the entire user object, right? So whoever calls this user form component is going to be able to pass the entire user object to be used in the form. But if you look here, the user object actually has more properties than what is used in the form. We have this ID property over here, which is not used directly in the form, right? It doesn't make sense to allow someone to edit their own ID. We're not putting that as part of the form. We just have all of these values here. However, in our case, it does make sense because what we're going to want to do eventually is in this onSubmit function, if we actually have a user, we're going to want to send a request to an endpoint that has the user's ID to be able to edit that specific user. So in our case, we actually do need the user's ID inside of this component, so it does make sense to put the entire user object over here. But if you had something else, like for example, I don't know, created at like so, and that would be probably of type date like so, you wouldn't put this in the form because this shouldn't be something that would be edited in the form, right? So in that case, you might want to omit that specific property just to make it very clear and very explicit about what this component is expecting, what it needs to actually do, the functionality that it needs to do, and only send that. It's always better to only send the things that are required instead of sending everything and just letting the component deal with it. But again, in our case, we are using every single property over here, including this ID, so it does make sense for us to actually use the entire user as props over here. Then we're going to come here and we're going to do, essentially, we're going to get the user here. So user like this, and that is going to be user form props. And we're going to have this user be accessible to this component. And now with this, we can use this user to determine if the form state should be editing or not. And if we should be in an editing state, then we want to use all of the properties of this user to actually set them as default values to the form. And in React Toke form, the way that you do that is you come here and you do default values and you provide an object that has all of the default values that you want to set for the form. So this can be any of these properties over here, and it doesn't have to be all of them. It can be just one of them or none of them, right? You can pass an empty object and that also works fine. So now what we want to do is we want to use this user to actually pass some default values. But first of all, we're not guaranteed to have a user, right? This user is optional, so we have to first make that check. So first we're going to do user and then question mark. Then if so, we're going to pass an object. Otherwise, we're going to pass undefined like so, because we don't want to set any default values if we don't have a user. And then to actually pass all of the user, what you might think of doing is just pass the user directly like so and just do user, right? And pass everything to default values. But again, remember, user has some properties that are not belonging to the form, like the ID property. So you don't want to do that. Instead, what I recommend that you do is actually create an object and pass every single property one by one manually explicitly. So for example, we can do birthday. We can pass the birthday and then user.birthday like so. And the reason you want to do this is, first of all, it's always better to be explicit about what you pass, because now it's very visual that, hey, we're passing all of these specific properties to the actual form. But the other thing is, in this case, user.birthday, if I hover over it, is of type date, and our form here actually expects a date as well. Birthday is z.date, which makes it of type date. But it can happen that your date in your database is not stored directly as a date, which really is hard with databases, and it's stored maybe as a string or as a number, right? And in that case, this wouldn't be a date. This would be a number like this, right? And now if you try to put this directly inside of the form, you're going to get an error that user.birthday of type number doesn't belong to the form, because here you're expecting a date. So what do you do? Well, in that case, you would take the user.birthday and you would do new date, and then you pass in user.birthday to convert it into a date for your form. So doing it this way, you can do it because now you have an object where you're passing everything explicitly, right? So there's two benefits to passing the object instead of the user directly. The first one is, in most cases, you're going to have to do some transformations to your actual values before you pass them in the form. And the second way is that now you see exactly what is being sent to the form and what isn't. We're not going to see an ID property here because we're not going to be sending it to the form, even though it does belong on the user. This makes it very clear. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to revert this, because we want to keep this as a date, because it'll just make our life a little bit simpler. And then we can do the rest of the properties. So we can do first name, user.firstname. We can do last name, user.lastname, email, user.email. Then I believe we had role and then birthday. So we're going to do, we already have birthday, so just role. We're going to do role, user.role like so. Right. So now with this, the beauty of using React Toke form is that all we have to do is just provide this default values object. And then every single one of our form is actually going to receive the default values as long as they're using this register function here. So we don't have to do anything else with these inputs over here. However, we do have to do something with the date picker and the select inputs and the components because we're doing things manually, right? We're not passing the register function. We're doing the custom on change and on value change functions. Now, luckily, if I open up this date picker over here, we have actually a default value prop, which is of type date. So this makes it really simple for us. We can directly come here and we can pass the default value. We can do default value and then make a check for user question mark. And then we're going to do user.birthday. Otherwise, we're going to do undefined like so. And now we've taken care of our date input, passing it the user's birthday as a default value if we have it. Then for the select, if we open up this component, you're actually not going to see all of the props because you have to dig a little bit deeper into the actual props from this library, Radix UI. But I can tell you for a fact that here, the select actually also receives a default value. And if I do it here, default value, you see that it is an option and we can provide an actual value. And again, we're going to do the same thing. We're going to user question mark user dot, and what are we doing here? It's role, so user dot role, otherwise undefined like so. And now with this, we've actually taken care of all of our inputs. Everyone gets their default value set. These three inputs over here get it directly from React Token Form, which is fine. We don't have to do anything. And the date picker and the select input gets it by this manual prop that we have to provide. This is totally fine. And this is a realistic scenario in a lot of React applications. You will probably have components that some inputs are like this, and then some other components are like this because you have to do things manually because you are limited. Obviously, I would have loved to actually have register here also apply to date picker and select. And to be real, I could do that. It would just require a little bit more work, but sometimes you can't. Sometimes you don't control these components and you can't directly register them in the way that you want to. And so you have to do things like this around it. That's totally fine. That's normal. And that's just part of the process. And now finally, the last thing that we have to do is inside of this onSubmit function, we have to make a check for the user. And then if the user is there, we send a different request. Otherwise, we send the same request over here. So that should be pretty simple. We can just do if user and then make an if check over here. And I'm actually going to take all of this code here and just paste it over here. Instead of API slash users, we're going to do slash users slash, and then here's where we're going to use user.id, right? That is why we had to pass it through the user object inside of this component, because we will need it inside of this component. If we didn't have to do this, honestly, I would not have passed the user's ID inside of this component. I would have passed only these values over here, because again, only these would have been used in the component. But now we need the user ID, so it does make sense for us to pass it. So this here passing the entire user does make sense. Then we're going to come here and instead of post, we're going to do patch because we're actually updating a user. And then here we're going to do else. And we're going to put the same code that we have here, which is just going to put it here inside of this block. So now onSubmit is aware of the user. If we have a user, it means that we're trying to edit something. So we're going to await fetch and then API slash user slash user.id. We have this because we know that there is a user inside of this if lock. Otherwise, if not, if there's no user, we're not in the editing mode, we're supposed to create an actual new user. So we're going to send a normal request, a post request to slash API slash users and send the same data in both requests. This works. And now all that we have to do is come back here to our app component. And now we can see that we have no errors if we don't provide a user. So in this case, we're going to be in the create state. And if we want to be able to edit the user, we can just do user and then we can pass it here an object. So we can do birthday, we can do new date, like so. We're not going to put any specific date. We're going to do first name. We're going to do Darius, like so. We're going to do then last name. We're going to put Cosden. Email, that's going to be email at cosdensolutions.io. I probably typed this wrong. Cosden. There we go. And then role is going to be what we have. Let's put editor. And then we're missing something, I believe. Yes, ID. We're going to do ID. An ID, I believe, should be a value of one, and we need a comma here, and now we can save. And now we've passed a user to this user form, and if we now go to our application, we should see if we refresh. There we go. We have all of the values here. We have the first name, last name, email, birthday, and so on, and everything works exactly as we expect. If we change any of these values, let's say from editor, we do viewer, and then we refresh, we're going to see that this automatically gets changed to viewer. And this works exactly as we expect, right? So this is the goal for this. What we wanted to do is we wanted to add easy edit functionality to this form. And this is perfectly justified, right? This user form can be used in a state where you want to create something, or if you want to edit a user, you can use the same component. So how this would look like is in this app component over here, perhaps you have a piece of state that says is editing. Perhaps we're on the profile page. Let's just imagine it for a second. And we have an edit button at the top right over here. When we press that, it changes the state to editing, and then this form receives the user, which we should have access to in the profile component. Probably we fetched it from the database, and then we can actually edit the user and get all of our updates saved to our database. Otherwise, if we're on a different page, if we're on the create user page, we can reuse the same component. We don't pass any user, and this is going to work exactly as we expect without the need for extra configuration. This is really simple. It doesn't bloat this component too much, and it really makes sense because this is a common use case. You want to have a form that you want to reuse for both creating and editing a specific entity, and this is perfectly valid. And then because this is your component, you can customize this a lot more. Let's say, for example, that you want to have an optional callback on success. So whenever this onSubmit actually sends the request and then it succeeds and it saves it to the database, maybe in the case of an edit, you want to redirect back to the user's profile. And maybe in the case of a success, you want to, of a creation, you want to redirect to the homepage, right? If so, you can just come here in the actual form and you can do onSuccess, question mark, and then put a function over here, define any arguments that you want, have it return anything that you want. And then this component, based on if it's editing or creating, can pass this on success over here, on success, and you can pass anything that you want. And you can customize this really in any way. You can plug this in any part of your application, and it is going to work. And the work that we did to implement this took less than 15 minutes, I believe, and only a few lines of code, but yet we've added so much functionality to this component. That is how you want to be building your React applications. And honestly, this is always what I try to teach in any of my React videos, and also in my course Project React. We go over this and we actually set up a form that looks just like this. The only difference is in Project React, you actually get to see how this fits in a whole application instead of getting just a little slice of it in a simple tutorial video like the one that you're watching. So honestly, if you're really serious about wanting to learn React, go and check out Project React. It'll be the first thing in the description. It is going to change your life. We're going to do everything that I showed in this video, but so much more, and we're actually building a project from start to finish, and I show you everything in exactly the same way that I've showed you this. You're going to understand React like you've never understood it before, and the students that I've taken this course so far are loving it, and it's completely changed the way that they view and build with React. So once again, it'll be the first link in the description. It's called Project React. Check it out, and I would love to see you on there. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos just like this one, make sure to leave this video a big thumbs up. You can also click here to subscribe, or you can click here to watch a different video of mine that YouTube seems to think that you're really going to enjoy. And with that being said, my name has been Darius Kozdan. This is Kozdan Solutions. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.